She said yes.
Tears away, swept in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. But as the thunder rolls, whisper through the rain. Every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, though my heart is torn. I will praise you in this storm. I remember when I stumbled in the wind. You heard my cry, you raised me up again. My strength is almost gone. How can I carry on if I can't find you? And as your thunder rolls, I barely hear whisper through the rain. I'm with you. But as your mercy is the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hand, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. When every tear I cry, you hold in your hand. You never left my side. My help come from, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I lift my eyes into the hill. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and every tear I cry, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, though my heart is torn. I will praise you in this storm. Though my heart is
well, this really fellow really needs very little introduction, but that doesn't mean I'm not going to say things. So I don't know if Peggy was making any when she said we got three, maybe four, maybe five. Maybe there's something that Peggy and Ashley's talking. No, that maybe you don't know about this. Maybe you don't. These guys were here. Actually, you've been there almost 7 years, right? Holy cow! He's been there almost 7 years, pastoring up at whatever Baptist church he's at, open something, whatever church of something. Not even close. Baptist church up there, up north, somewhere's yonder. I do know it. Calvary. There it is. Bible church. In some town that none of us have ever heard of. It's terrible. But they were here with us for a number of years. And if you remember, of course, what thing that Peggy, some of you might not know this, which is kind of hard to believe, but how long ago was the accident? Really? It was in 2010 that there was an accident. They were in a car accident. And as far as we know, Jonathan's arm is still broken because he's never been told otherwise. He's broke his arm. He was pretty out of it, too. I mean, there was several minutes that he didn't remember right away. It took a while for it to come back. But Ashley was in a coma for 8 days, I believe. And even after that, it was, some of you remember, there was a bunch of us went up to her birthday party at the hospital, and she doesn't remember any of that. It was on video. It was pretty awkward. But if you know Ashley, that's not unusual. So, but, you know, it was the miracle of all of that. I mean, step after step, first, whether or not she was going to wake up, the doctors literally told us, we don't know if she'll ever wake up. And the next day she woke up. One of the doctors said to Jonathan, when she was at rehab, they said, what kind of expectations do you have over this? And what are your hopes? And Jonathan said, I would like to be able to someday have a conversation with my wife again. And the doctor said, we'll see. And he didn't sound really hopeful. Probably now he's wishing that she would shut up every once in a while. But Ashley's my niece, if you don't know. But another thing they said was, now they basically said this for sure. They said, she can never have children. Now she can't stop having kids. She's like a rabbit. So praise the Lord. This is a miracle. It's a miracle right before our eyes, and what a blessing. And the fact that Jonathan has been pastoring for 7 years is right up there on the scale of God parting the Red Sea. So with that introduction, sir, I saw him last night. He goes, this is terrible. I like to, and I know you guys think I'm random. I like to think of it as spontaneous. Saw him last night at the funeral, and he goes, I'll see you again in the morning. I said, you're going to be at church in the morning? He said, yeah. I said, you want to preach? And he goes, you're kidding? I said, kind of, no. I said, seriously, if you want the day off, I said, he goes, I'll preach. I'm like, cool. I thought, this is perfect because I want him down here. But if we call him to come down here, then we got to pay him. But he's already down here, so this is awesome.
I'll sit down and shut up now.
This is like preaching in surround. Because this is really all meant for you. Yeah. That's your choice. Doesn't matter to me. Thanks for stopping by. Yeah, you're going to take notes. We'll follow. Nice. All right. That was it. All right. Well, thank you for that wonderful introduction, Pastor. I appreciate it. Today, we're really only going to look at one sentence in the Bible. So it just so happens this one sentence is the longest sentence in the entire New Testament, at least in the Greek. So if you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Ephesians. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. That is one consistent, one total sentence in the Greek. And I'm hoping as we read this today, my hope is that this just bombards our minds, that it really penetrates our hearts, and that this would be an absolutely profound little section of Scripture that would speak to us today. So Ephesians chapter 1. Can I move this out of the way? I can. There it is. All right. Ephesians chapter 1, 3 through 14. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. So let me just start off by asking, do you honestly believe right now that as a follower of Jesus Christ, that you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places? Is that something that you live practically today, right now? And now maybe as you're sitting there and you're looking at me with a little bit of blank stares going, I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. Okay? So hopefully at the end of all of this today, maybe this profound truth, this reality of being a believer in Christ will really echo in our hearts and our minds today. But before we dig any deeper into this, I want to give you the title. This title today is Who Are We in Christ? And then let's pray. Dear Lord, this is such an awesome passage of Scripture. It is so rich, and our time together today, Lord, will never do it justice. And so, God, I pray as we scratch the surface of this, that you will take your word and you will change and absolutely, radically overhaul our hearts. Help us to see our situation. Help us to see who we are in light of who you say we are. Lord, I pray that you will use this in a big, big way in our lives today. And we thank you for it. And we pray this in your precious name. Amen. Ephesians chapter 1, we'll start with verse 4. The beginning of it says, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. The first thing you need to notice, okay, we are chosen in Christ. The word chosen, it means to pick out. It means to select for oneself. this concept, it is more than just looking down the corridor of time and being able to say, okay, sometime down that way, that person is going to accept by faith me. It is more than that. What this is saying is God chose you, he handpicked you. Okay, let me give you an illustration to drive this home. I don't know if you are familiar with the it's a singing competition called The Voice. Okay, so this one, the way that they do it is everyone, that there's four judges, and they all turn their back. Okay, and then someone comes on up, I'm still going to keep talking, and they'll come on up, and as they come, they start to sing, and you don't get to see who they are, but you hear their voice. And if you like them, the judge will hit a button. And the moment they do, the whole chair spins, and there's this big sign that lights up that says, I want you. Okay? And if you've ever seen that, this idea, here, there's a little bit of a parallel with what is happening here. God's act of choosing us, it is not based on us in the slightest. But God, when he hits that button, it's kind of like before you open your mouth, okay? Before you even walked out on the stage, God hit that button and said, you, I want that one. That one right there. I want them. I choose you. Imagine that. That's incredible. That is an absolutely awesome truth. God chose us knowing full well that I am a filthy, rotten, dirty, pastor will tell you, all of the nasty, horrible things that make me me. And he doesn't even know all of them. And I don't know all of them. But here's the thing, God does. And he still chooses me. Wow, that is a profound truth that opens our eyes and our hearts. God is way more committed to you and I than we have ever been or ever could be committed to him. We have done nothing to deserve it, and we will never be able to repay it, but God has graciously chosen us. That's the first thing. As he goes through it, Paul is writing this. That's the first thing that he encounters. The second thing is, we are holy and blameless in Christ. The whole verse 4, it says, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Now, we're going to dissect both of those words. The first one is holy. It literally means set apart. It means above reproach, morally pure, upright, blameless in heart and life. All believers are holy because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Our holiness, there's actually a word called imputed. Our holiness is imputed. What it means is God has placed on us Christ's holiness. Now, the word imputed, it is actually a legal term. And it means that there is a transaction that has taken place. Okay? On one hand, believers, they take on Christ's holiness. God, he ends up viewing believers through the shed blood of his holy and sinless Son. So there is a transaction that happens. And the other side of that is God, he imputed our sin on his Son when Jesus died. Jesus, a good term is he bore all of our sinfulness, and it was nailed to the cross. In 1 Peter chapter 2, 24, it speaks specifically of that, who his own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripe ye were healed. Jesus took our sin so that we would be able to be presented sinless. It's incredible. Blameless is the second word. And this word, it means without blemish or spot. It means guiltless, uncondemned. This is my favorite of all of them. It means presented as not able to be charged in court. Okay, I'll give you an example of this. For those of you that were around in the 80s, maybe you are familiar with the guy by the name of John Gotti. Okay, John Gotti, he was a big mafia boss, if you're not familiar with him. He had a nickname called Teflon Don. And the reason he got this nickname is in the 80s, there were all of these charges that they kept bringing him into court, and nothing seemed to stick. He just kept getting by, and they never seemed to get him into prison, although he seemed to always be very shady and involved in a lot of things. Just nothing stuck. Teflon Don. Okay, eventually he's caught. Eventually he's put in prison for the rest of his life. That has nothing to do with what we're talking about. But I will say this. This is a really cool idea. Okay? It seems, even though nothing could stick to him, in the same way with us, because of Jesus Christ's substitutionary death, my sins, and if you've placed your trust in Jesus, your sins, they don't stick. And so I think about that in my own way. For me, maybe I could be kind of like Teflon John. Thank you. Pause. I'll let you laugh. Catch up on it. So who you are in Christ, it is so profound. Okay? There are no charges, past, present, or future, that stick to you. None of that. Believers are able to be presented without sin. They are to be presented with no charge on their account to the court, only because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. One commentator, speaking of this, he said, Christ dying for all of our sins, all our guilt being placed upon Christ, that means nothing is held against us. Everything unholy or worthy of blame or anything worthy of incurring guilt, every spiritual spot, wrinkle, and blemish was fully taken care of in Jesus' death. God no longer sees any of those imperfections. The perfect righteousness of Christ now clothes us and covers us. When God looks at a believer, someone who is united with him by faith, God only sees Christ. The third thing I want to draw out from this passage is we're adopted in Christ. It says this in verses 5 and 6, having predestined us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. Now, here's an interesting fact about adoption. Adoption really wasn't something that was a big Jewish concept. So when Paul is writing this, he is really speaking about the Roman idea of adoption. And all of the Roman men, they were required, they were actually forced to pass along all their wealth onto their son or sons. And if they didn't have a son, or if they felt that their son was unworthy, what they would end up doing is they would go and adopt a son. That's how they would go about this. Once adopted, this new son would have all of his debts canceled. And not only would he have all of his debts canceled, he would also be given a new name. It's really cool. This adoption, it was something that was irreversible. It could not be changed. It could not be undone. It was a forever altered reality for that person. It was a forever commitment. When it comes to our adoption by our Heavenly Father, our adoption is not based on any of our worthiness. God simply adopts people because he chooses to. He loves you. In other translations, it actually says he lavishes his love upon you. It's incredible. Ephesians 1, 7a, a little bit further on, it says, in whom we have redemption through his blood. Okay? The fourth thing we want to see is we're redeemed in Christ. The word redemption, it means to purchase, to be freed by ransom, to buy out, or to release by payment. Today, when we think of this idea of redemption, maybe you've seen like Redemption Center where you take bottles and cans and they're able to take those and they recycle them, and because you've turned them in, you get some money for it. Okay, that's the idea that kind of normally comes to our mind. When we think of the metal or the plastic bottles, we turn each one in and you get 5 cents. Historically, though, when Paul is writing this, what is actually happening, the idea of redemption, it was connected to the idea of purchasing the price of a slave. It was to purchase a slave's freedom. Until the price of that slave was paid, until they were redeemed, that slave remained under bondage. Jesus' death, it satisfies our debt. It removes us from underneath the wrath of God, okay? Before this ever happens, we are sitting there kind of like Pigpen. If you've ever listened to like Peanuts cartoons or you've watched any of the movies, there's a character called Pigpen. And every time he walks around, he's got this ominous, awful, dark cloud over top of him. That is each and every one of us left to our own means. That is the looming wrath of God over us. The only thing that changes that is the substitutionary, once for all, substitutionary, sacrificial death of Christ. That's it. Jesus' death, he pays the price for our sin. He redeems us. Jesus, he takes our punishment, which our sin demands. And Jesus places his righteousness upon our accounts. Jesus' substitutionary sacrifice means I do not have to pay my own sins for my own self, because Jesus already did that on my account. However, for redemption to actually work, okay, there has to be this, this transferring that takes place on my account. And I have to actually receive this by faith. Okay, let me give you an illustration of this. Say I was to pull out my checkbook and I was to write a $500 check to you. Okay, my money, I have it in the bank. It is a good, valid check. I filled it out all appropriately. I hand you the check, and all you go and do is you frame the check. Like, it's a pretty check. You really did a nice job with that check. I like that check. You never cash it. You never actually deposit it. None of that money actually ever gets into your account. That's exactly what's happening here. In order for us to receive that redemption, there is a transaction that has to take place. You have to receive it. That free gift must be taken by you, and it has to be then applied to your account. And again, the only way that is ever done is by faith in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Number 4, we're forgiven in Christ. All of verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Now this word sin, it is actually an archery term, and it means to miss the mark, okay? And it actually goes beyond that. So if I aimed at that clock, and I wound up and I threw as hard as I could, and I missed the clock, I would actually hit another target, even though that wasn't the one I was aiming for. And so that's what you kind of see with this. All of us have missed God's standard of perfection. In order to see the true value of forgiveness, you really need to see who we naturally are apart from forgiveness. We need to see our need for forgiveness. Each of us, we have an astronomical debt that needs to be forgiven. We are all sinning. As I said, we are under that wrath of God. Forgiveness, it means to let go. It means to release, to send away. In Christ, all of our sins have been forgiven. Those sins have been released. Those sins have been sent away. Okay, I'll give you an illustration of this. Now, when I was growing up, there was a TV show called Extreme Makeover Home Edition. That was the one with Ty Pennington, that really obnoxious guy with a megaphone. Move that bus! Okay, maybe you never saw it. But in the show, basically the way that it works is they would go and there would be someone that was hard-pressed. They were kind of down on their luck. They had gone through a really difficult patch in their life. And then this group would come on in and they would build this gorgeous, like custom-made, tailor-made home for this couple or this family. And then what they would do in certain episodes, another group would come alongside them and they'd be like, yeah, I know you just built that. And there's normally like a good expense that goes along with that. We call that a mortgage. Yeah, this other group would be like, we're going to pay the mortgage. You don't have to even worry about paying anything for that. And I think about that. And it's so cool. That is exactly what has been done on our behalf in Christ. In Christ, all of our debt has been canceled. In Christ, there is no more payments because it is finished. In Christ, we are free and clear. It has all been taken care of on our behalf. We have been forgiven. Our sin has been released. The sixth thing, we've obtained an inheritance in Christ. This is in verses 11 and 12. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ. This word inheritance, it means to allot, to assign as in a privilege. Okay? God deliberately and intentionally gives his children this inheritance. It is not something that is done random. This is something that is done with intention and precision. Okay? This whole thing, it is not only that God, he gives us this inheritance. God is the one who secures that inheritance. And God will never allow anything to happen to that inheritance. Okay, I'll give you kind of a little illustration of this. Maybe you're familiar with the founder of Amazon, Jeff Bezos, very rich guy, from what I have researched and found out, at least at the time when I researched it. He's about $187 billion in wealth. That is his total accumulated net worth. Very close. It was Jeff Bezos, Jonathan Rayder. We're very close to all that. But if you don't know this, Jeff Bezos has four children. And so if you think about this, when it comes time for inheritance, okay, if something was to happen, if and when, and if there's no like special alterations to his will, these four children are going to split that $187 billion equally. And for you math scholars, that's about roughly $50 billion per kid. Now, I have three children. And let's just say they will be lucky to get $50 per kid if split equally. But I want to tell you all of this, okay? I think sometimes why we kind of downplay the whole inheritance is because we don't really understand it. Okay, process this. The God who created you, the God who knew you before you were even formed in your mother's womb, that very same God, he died for you, he rose again in your place, and that God has gone to prepare a place for you, with you on his mind. Do you possibly think that this place is not the best possible place that could ever have ever been created? It is specifically tailor-made for you. Anything that you that he knows makes you go, oh, I'm excited. That means there's eclairs for me. It means that there's an ice cream bar. A lot of things that are centered with food. But there's a lot of fun things. I think about that. And I think about this. It's not just what you get to be involved in. No, it is that you get to spend all of eternity in his presence. I can only imagine, okay? George, he just passed away. I can imagine when he got there, Jesus was like, George, come with me. I got to show you this. I've made this. for you. I made this with you in mind. Let's go spend some time and do this together. Yes, please. I think about that verse in Revelation 21. And it says in that passage where Jesus, or God, he will wipe away every tear from our eyes. And I tell you, I think a lot of times when I thought about that verse, it's like the difficulties I've had to endure. And while that's entirely biblically true, I'm not downplaying that. I think sometimes it might actually also be all of the things that I have done, those regrets. Because there's going to be a day where I have to stand before God and give an account. And when I go, it's like everything is played, maybe like a movie before my eyes, and I'm going to be like, why didn't I share Jesus with that person? Why didn't I care enough to read my Bible? What was so important in my life? Why was I so busy about accumulating wealth on earth? What was I possibly thinking? And I think about all of that, at least if it's me, I'm there and I got this flood of emotions and I'm going, really? And our loving Heavenly Father, he's going to be there. Yeah, it's all true. He's not going to say, oh no, that never happened. But he's going to be there to wipe away those tears. He's going to say, it's okay in Christ. It's incredible. This really is awesome. The last one, we've been sealed with the Holy Spirit in Christ. Verses 13 and 14. And whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. You understand that God, he has sealed us, okay? God has marked us by the Holy Spirit. This concept, it is kind of like the idea for you farmers, okay? It's like the branding of a cow, okay? It is kind of like Paul's time, it's like the branding of a slave. Their skin, what happens is you get this iron really, really hot, and you get it all like red and glowing, and then you just bury it. And then it just sizzles. And you like smell you smell like hamburgers and all that. And so you do that. And what happens is you are identifying, that person is being identified. It's a really cool concept. This mark, it shows ownership. It also deters any thief from stealing because the owner's seal is visible. It was identified. You could see who this person or this animal belongs to. And that is exactly what the seal of the Holy Spirit does for those in Christ. The Holy Spirit testifies that we are a blood-bought, born-again child of the King. We are owned by him. He has marked us. He has sealed us. The Holy Spirit is proof that we have a living, vibrant relationship with God. So, let me leave you with a couple of challenges. First one, are you in Christ? We just went through a lot of the really awesome benefits of being in Christ. Has there ever been a time in your life that you know for certain that you have placed your faith in the person and work of Christ? You understand, at the end of the day, there is absolutely nothing else that is going to matter a hill of beans. Every single one of us has to stand before God and give an account. And if you do not know, okay, the Bible, it is written so that you may know you have eternal life. God does not want you playing a guessing game about this. He does not want you to get to the end of your life being like, well, maybe, possible. Or thinking that, oh, when I get there, there's this big, giant scale awaiting me. where I've got good works. Oh boy, I did good things. I helped old ladies across the street. I did not steal any candy from babies. I was a good person, Lord. Look at those things. And then we try to downplay all of the other ones that we know are bubbling and festering under the surface. Now, I don't know about you. I've actually had to go to court because I sped. And as I did, I went to the court and I knew I was guilty. The cop pulled me over and I was dead to rights. It was foolish. I had no reason to. And he said, all right, you got to go to court. Here it is. Boom. So I went. And I stood before the court. I'm guilty. I mean, it's like you stand there and I go like 100 miles an hour. I didn't do this. But it's like I go 100 miles an hour in a school zone. And then I stand before that judge. And the judge goes, well, I didn't know you helped all those old ladies across the street. You are fine. You don't have to worry about any of what you've done that is wrong. Sure, you put everyone's life in danger. Sure, you were dead to rights and guilty. But no, you were a good person. Do you possibly think that that's going to be a reality awaiting you? Because if you are, I have a bridge in New York to sell you. It's for a cheap price of about $5,000. Okay? I'm going to tell you today, God's word verifies this. There is a day of judgment coming. Okay? It's a very scary day for some. Those that are not in Christ, it is a petrifying, knee-knocking day. It says in Scripture that every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. There is no atheists at the end of the day. There's no fence riders at the end of the day. You will know your faith, or maybe lack thereof, will be made sight. You will behold face to face the glory of the One, the God, the Creator. What are you going to do? Now, if you haven't dealt with it before you get there, that's a bad moment. But let me tell you, while there is breath in your lungs, it is not too late. Man, it is so good. Because here's the thing. I know I've blown it. And I am not going to stand before the Lord going, look at my good deeds. No. By grace you have been saved through faith. Not of your own works, lest any man should boast. If I was to do that, it wouldn't be based on God's grace. It would be based on, Lord, look at all of the good things I've done. Aren't I awesome? I deserve heaven, don't I? And you don't. Just like I don't. But that's where Jesus comes in. Because God knew we blew it. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. He knew we blew it. For the wages of sin is death. Wow. Eternal separation is what that's talking about. I don't want that. I don't want it for myself. And I desperately don't want it for anyone here. And it's not too late. The wage, I think about that. You do something, you earn money. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. There's a gift. Just like redemption that we talked about, that $500 check, it's offered. It's being held out. Will you receive it? And if not, why not? What is possibly your hang-up? I can't possibly think of any reason. Now, I know several of you. And I know some of you have accepted Jesus as your personal Savior. And if you are in Christ right now, let me ask you, do you live life in that reality? Is this something that is ever before your mind's eye as you go on off, as you interact with your jobs, as you interact with your spouse, as you interact with your children? Are you really fully aware that you are in Christ? What that really means is in Christ, you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. You are filthy rich in Christ. In Christ, you have been chosen before the foundation of the world. in Christ, you are holy and blameless. There's not a spot of guilt on your account. In Christ, you are adopted. You are a child of God. In Christ, you have been redeemed. You have been bought with a price. In Christ, you are forgiven. All of your past, present, and future sins have been paid for in full. In Christ, you have obtained an inheritance far beyond just a little cherub that is sitting on a cloud playing a harp in a diaper. This thing is amazing what awaits us. And in Christ, you have been sealed with the Holy Spirit. He holds you tight. I hope this reality bombards you and it really challenges the way that we view ourselves, that it helps us to see in Christ how God sees each and every one of us. Let me pray. Lord, I am so thankful for your word. Lord, I love the book of Ephesians. Lord, it is written to a group of people, Lord, that they were facing a hostile environment. Lord, this place, Ephesus, it was a hub of wicked, carnal activities. Lord, our world, we are living in it, but we are not of it. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that as much as this world seems to be spinning in chaos, there is one who is sovereign. There is one that holds it all secure. And that same one wants each and every one of us. He's chosen you. He's lavished his love on you. He's redeemed you and adopted you. He desires you. What do we do with Jesus? Lord, help us. Lord, I pray, Lord, that this reality will change us. It'll open our eyes. Lord, I love how the first three chapters of Ephesians, it really talks about who we are in Christ. It bombards us with that. And the rest is because of who you are in Christ. Now, how are you going to live in Christ? That's the challenge for those who have accepted that free gift. What do we do? How do we live practically, day by day in Christ? Help us to understand that present reality and help that to change us. And we love you. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Let's keep our heads bowed for a second. Couple questions. I wonder if there's anybody here that'd be willing to slip up your hand and say, you know what, maybe the Lord put his finger on something specifically. Maybe you've been kind of discouraged. Whatever it is, you say, you know what, the Lord spoke to me in some way. The Lord spoke to me this morning. I need prayer. Pray for me. Pray for me. Yes, 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 yes. Pray for me. Yes. Pray for me. Yes, yes. One more question. Are you in Christ? Let me put it this way. Do you know for sure that if you died today that you'd go to be with the Lord, that you'd go to heaven? Maybe you're sitting here going, man, you know what? I'd like in on this deal. I'm not sure if I'm part of this thing, but I'd like in on this. This sounds like, or there's another party going, what's the catch? Well, there is no catch. You say, well, I want in. What do? We're going to sing a song here in a second, but I know we sing songs and you've heard this song forever, but let me turn to page 62. Just as I am. This is, man, there's so much in this. It says, just as I am, without one plea. Jonathan mentioned the court setting, standing before the judge. You know, I have nothing to say. I have no plea. I have nothing I can say on my own behalf. Without one plea, except for this, your word says you shed your blood for me. And that thou bidst me come to thee. if you're here this morning and you don't know for sure that you're on your way to heaven, I can almost guarantee you that there's a little voice in you right now saying, you need this. You need this. Why don't you do this? Why don't you consider this? I remember when I got saved, it was like that little voice, you're not saved, you need to be saved. I didn't understand everything about it, but I knew I wasn't, and I thought, man, I need to do this. If you're here this morning, and that's you, with nobody looking, I'm not doing this to embarrass anybody, but if you don't know for sure that you're on your way to heaven, I wonder if you'd be just willing to just put your hand up and put it right back down and just say, you know, pray for me, I don't know. I got to be honest with you, I'm not sure. Pray for me that I'll get this thing settled. Yes. Pray for me. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for your love for us. God, I thank you for that still small voice. Lord, I thank you, God, that you call us to yourself. Lord, I pray for these ones that raise their hand for various reasons. Lord, you know. God, I pray, God, that your will be accomplished in each heart and life this morning. And Lord, for if there's anybody here, anybody even else that's here that doesn't know for sure, God, I pray, Lord, that this will be the day that they come just as they are. Lord, they don't have to do anything or quit anything, God, just as they are, just the sinners that they are. God, I pray, God, that this will be the day. Lord, I pray now that you'll bless these closing moments. In Jesus' name, amen.